Turn your Bibles to the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 3, Hebrews chapter 3. And I'm going to try to move us a little bit further along than we got last Sunday out of the book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 3. Again, we've been talking about the corporate anointing of God, and the corporate anointing of God is revealed in the book of Acts. It is the greatest power source, or greatest manifestation of God's power available to God's people. You can study it, you can look at the book of Acts, and you can see that the power of God born out of the corporate flow, the corporate action of the body of Christ, coming together in one accord, coming together in corporate prayer. You'll find that that over and over again throughout the book of Acts and throughout history, history records it over and over, that it became the springboard, or you might say the birthing place of really every great revival and every move of God that has ever been ushered into this earth. And the corporate power of God has ability to go beyond. It's the power of God at a measure beyond our own faith. Our own faith is primarily the faith that you receive. Every person, the Bible says, has every born-again believer has received the measure of faith. Now, it's up to you what you do with that faith. That faith can either grow. The Bible says the church at Thessalonica, as Paul commended them, he said, your faith is growing more and more. It grows exceedingly. The Bible tells us how faith is increased. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And so if your life is not brought under the working, the auspices, the hearing of the Word of God, and brought under those workings on a consistent and continual basis, your faith suffers as a result. But to every person, every born-again believer has been given the measure of faith. Now, we determine what is done with that. And God gives us that measure of faith we begin with, and our faith can grow, our faith can increase. If our faith can increase, then that would indicate that if we don't do the things that produce or make for increase of our faith, then our faith would be decreased. How many of you can understand that? If we don't hear the Word of God, and we're just exposed to the world, the world system, the world's way of doing things, the information that's coming to us from this, you know, lost, dying, you know, corrupted world and world system, then we're going to think like, and our belief system is going to be, you know, like the world. And if our belief system is like the world, what you believe, you eventually, you know, act on. And what's going to end up happening is you get what the world gets. Instead of receiving and walking in and maximizing getting what God has promised belongs to us. So there's a great consequence to becoming lax when it concerns your personal faith. Now, your personal faith primarily has to do with you receiving from God. Now stay with me here. Your personal faith has primarily to do with you receiving from God. Jesus said, as you have believed, so be it done unto you. So your belief system and your actions based upon that belief system are really going to determine how life is to you, how your quality of life, the quality of life that you experience, the quality and quantity of the life of God, the things of God that you experience. And so that's determined by your faith level and you acting on your faith, living by faith. The Bible says the just shall live by faith. Let me make another statement here. I said your faith is primarily for you in receiving from God. Now that's primarily. You can't use your faith to control other people. Now I'm going to say that again. You can pray for other people, but when it comes to your individual prayers, there is a limit in the sense that you cannot control another human being's will. They have a will, a free sovereign will. Your prayers will generate God maybe dealing with that person to a certain point, but it will not exert control over that person. But your faith does impact your life, impact your family, those that are within your sphere of care. But primarily, your faith has been given unto you to affect you as an individual, to open up your life, to God moving in your life, God ministering in your life. Now, there's something called the corporate anointing that exceeds what we're able to do on a personal level with our personal faith. And you'll find that throughout Scripture. Now listen closely. When Peter and John were going to the temple for the hour of prayer, the Bible says they came across a lame man. And the Bible says the lame man was crying out to them, begging. He wanted money. He wanted to receive money. Bible says that crippled man was crippled from his mother's womb. He was born with that crippling affliction. And it says as he cried out and was begging for money in Acts chapter 3, it says Peter and John turned to him and they began to take notice of him. And they said, "Silver and gold have I none." Don't have any money to give you, but such as I have, I give unto you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. The Bible says that the man, his ankle bone and his feet began to receive strength supernaturally. The Bible says the man leaped up off of that cot that he was limited to and began to leap and jump and shout and praise God. And the Bible called what happened to this man a notable miracle. Now let me show you something here. A notable miracle occurred. Now notice, it happened, that notable miracle happened right outside the corporate prayer meeting that they were going to give themselves to for an hour, called the hour of prayer. Apparently they met daily right after Acts chapter 2 when they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. They realized this, that they were filled in the upper room. The Bible says they're in one place, in one accord. And in that place of one accord, the Bible says God, the Holy Ghost came suddenly, filled that place where they were gathered together in one accord praying and filled them. And the fire of God came upon their life. And the Bible says out of that, thousands, literally thousands, began to be influenced by that corporate anointing that was flowing through them and flowing from them and flowing out of that prayer meeting. That was initial burst of God's Spirit that swept literally thousands into the kingdom of God. Now, here Peter and John, they're going back to the temple. I guess they figured if prayer got the kind of results that thousands were coming to the knowledge of God, it'd be a good idea to keep praying. Amen? It'd be a good idea to keep giving themselves to prayer. And so here they come back, daily hour of prayer. This notable miracle occurs, and the Bible says that notable just simply means God moved by His power in such manner that nobody could deny that what happened to this man was a miracle, was a divine intervention of God, that God's power showed up, changed this man's life in a drastic and dramatic way. Everybody in the community knew that he was the man that was laid at the gate of the temple and begged for money. Now he's no longer crippled. Now he's no longer laying there, not able to do what other people can do. He's up, running, leaping, praising God. You think about this. He had never ever walked before. So it's a miracle that his body was healed. But it's also a miracle that he jumped up, began to leap, shout, run around and praise God. Because, you know, you got to learn to walk. You got to learn to walk. This man had never walked before. Even if he would have been healed and received strength, he would have had to have some type of rehabilitation. But thank God, with one stroke of God's power, one manifestation of God's power, not only was his body made fit and his body made well, and what was impossible with man was possible through the power of God. What doctors could have never done, man could have never done. Instantly, by the stroke of God's hand, this man is made completely whole, completely strong. But not only completely whole and strong, he's running around, leaping, praising God, and shouting. The whole community erupted. People were being swept in to the kingdom of God, being saved. This is still something that's being born out of God's people coming together and praying corporately. And then the religious leaders got upset. the governmental leaders got upset. They went and apprehended Peter and John. They began to talk to them. And Peter and John, you know, the Bible says that Peter wasn't about to shut up about Jesus. He wasn't about to quit preaching the gospel. And Peter stood up to them. The Bible says he stood up with a loud voice and stood up to them, telling them, you can't do this anymore. You're causing trouble in the city. They weren't causing trouble. People getting healed, people getting set free, people getting saved by the power of God, people being delivered by the power of God. But it was intimidating to the government officials. It was intimidating to the religious people of his day, of their day. So they call them in, they threaten them. They literally threatened them with their life. They said, you keep preaching in the name of Jesus. You keep doing things like this in the name of Jesus. We're going to have you back in here. We're going to have your life. And the Bible says they threatened them, let them go. Now listen to this. And then in Acts chapter 4, it says they went back to their own company. Everybody say their own company. Their own company would indicate they had a local church. Now listen closely, there were thousands of people by this time, somewhere in the neighborhood of probably 10 to 12,000 believers. But they went back to their own company. The Bible says they reported everything that the chief priests had said, everything that the leaders had said, and then they all lifted their voice. Now listen closely, their company, their local church, the church they belonged to, it was their church, their company, the part of the body of Christ that they were plugged into and a part of. It said they all began to lift their voice with one accord. Everybody say one accord. That simply means they began to pray and employ the power of one accord. Now you'll find three things in the book of Acts that you see over and over that produce the corporate anointing of God. Now that is a power, listen closely, that goes beyond our faith, our individual faith. Us as an island within ourselves could never generate or produce that type of power, the potential that is released through these three things that the Bible talks about. There are three things, and that is you have to have your own company. You'll never know the place of one accord without your own company. Now listen to me closely. What does that do for you individually? Well, what your faith can't do, even though you may be faithfully, you love God, faithfully serving God, you've met up against something where there's an impasse and you've had no breakthrough, but when you come together in that place of your company, if you follow the Bible pattern, there is something called one accord that begins to be generated and take place, and that one accord state begins to usher in the power of God that goes beyond the level that your own personal faith is able to generate. No, no.